Emmanuel. So Emmanuel is coming from ENR Institute, and he will talk about the key people for change. Hi, Emmanuel.
Hi, thank you, Nicolas. I'm going to share my screen.
Yes, please.
If you can confirm that it is okay.
It should be.
Okay. Normally, it's cool. Ready.
I don't see your slide.
Oh, sorry.
Did you share it?
I'm going to try it again. So normally it should work now.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I'm going to introduce very briefly myself. I am Emmanuel Laroche. I'm working as a sustainable IT manager inside Airbus. Today, this presentation is related to my membership and to the membership of Airbus inside the Institute for Sustainable IT, what we call the INR in France. I'm going to introduce very briefly the topic. This morning, I know that you have seen how to define the green IT as a transition between the two major transitions we are going to see during this century. So the convergence of these two transitions. We can leave the digital transition everywhere and every day, of course. It is not the case for the environmental and energetic transition. We can see that it is a clearly lower transition, but we have to make it converge to build a resilient and sustainable future. To illustrate why we should focus on sustainable IT and green IT inside organization and especially inside large companies, I've taken the page 3 of the World Economic Forum report. So clearly it's not the forum of Greenpeace, it's a World Economic Forum with people who are specialized in economics and finance. And if I consider at the top risk that are present on this slide, in terms of impact here or in probability there, you can see that if we consider the 9 main risks, we have 6 risks that are related to environment directly with a climate action failure, extreme weather, biodiversity, and so on. 2 links related directly to IT with cyber attacks and information system breakdown. And the 9th one is the infectious diseases with the COVID crisis. So you can see that the COVID crisis is lower in terms of probability and lower in terms of impact. So clearly, if we want to have a resilient strategy in our companies, we have to focus on the 8 risks that are upper. I know that this morning you have seen a large figure, so I just remind that 4% of greenhouse gases are relative to IT considering the whole life cycle. I'm just going to develop a bit that today the people who are putting the pressure on large firms and large international companies are clearly the shareholders. Of course, there is pressure coming from a non-governmental organization, coming from employees themselves or from young generations. But the pressure is clearly with shareholders who are worried about their invest and their exposure to the climate change risk and to the impacts on climate change too. So there is a double engagement of shareholders there. Why are they worried? I'm going just to take an illustration with PG&E company. So it is a Pacific Gas and Electricity company. That is a company that supplies the Silicon Valley with electricity. So the electricity, it is the energy vector that everybody wants to decarbonize the industry and the human activities for this century. We could believe that when we are supplying the Silicon Valley, that is a growth with about 10 to 50% per year, we will have a good future. But PG&E is today in bankruptcy. PG&E is not a company that is more responsible than the others for the climate change or for the dryness that occurred in California. but they were responsible for the first electrical arcs that have produced the fire in Paradise. And the Wall Street Journal, that is not the journal of Greenpeace, has titled saying PG&E, first victim of the climate change and probably not the last one. So clearly, it was an example that I took inside Airbus to convince people that we were exposed to such risk. Now, with the COVID crisis, I don't need to develop too much. And just to illustrate also that we are at risk of public bashing, especially on the question of waste of electronical equipment. To illustrate what was said this morning, I just take the result of life cycle assessment done by the French Agency for Environment with the French electrical mix that is already very decarbonized to illustrate what is the part relative to the raw material extractions in terms of climate change impact. So it is in blue. And you can see that for each type of equipment that we are consuming, desktop, TVs, and so on, every time it is clearly the phase of the life cycle that is the most impacting. So I've just give you the link to this study that was very interesting. And I think it is available both in French and in English. This is also to illustrate that, of course, climate change is the main risk that we want to cover and the main impact, environmental impact that we have to consider, but it is not the only one. And I take the example of another life cycle assessment that was done in South Korea with the South Korean electrical mix that is more carbonized than French for sure. It is a quite old study. 2006, but it is quite difficult to have such a complete life cycle assessment. And you can see that when we consider other environmental impacts, such as abiotic resources depletion, acidification of soil, ozone layer in light blue, or eutrophization, it means the loss of oxygen inside the biotopes or toxicities. Clearly, the pre-manufacturing, so the raw material extraction, is clearly the phase that is the most impacting. And even if the manufacturing is done in countries of South Asia, where we have a lot of carbon inside the electricity, it's not the main consuming phase. The distribution is not either. And the end of life can be very impacting, especially in terms of human toxicities, due to the fact that we have about 2,000 chemical products inside any computers. So I am going to be very fast to say that Green IT at the convergence of the two transition should have a good future, but we have also to face conflict of usage on electricity itself, on water that is used both to manufacture our equipment and to supply the electrical network, to cool down the electrical network. Especially when we have a large nuclear power station, as it is the case in France. So the two conflicts of usage are mixed. And we have also conflict of usage on metals and a part of metals that are the what we call the rare earths that are used in some renewable energies, but they can be substituted quite easily in renewable energies, in photovoltaics or wind turbines. It is quite easy, and generally they are not very so present that we believe, but they are very present in our IT tools. They are very used also in all new products relative to energy efficiency. By example, LED products. If you don't have gallium, you are not able to build any LED products. So it is a very large disruption to have lighting with LED products, and it can divide by four the electrical consumption for lighting. But today we are using metals that are quite critical and badly recycled. So you've seen that the raw material phase is the most impacting, but the end of life is not good at all either. We have 70% of electrical and electrical equipment that are going to finish their life in landfills in Ghana, in Nigeria, or in India. These figures are quite easy to verify because Interpol is working on this topic and confirm these figures. And moreover, for journalists, it is quite easy to use GPS tracker to put it in the panels of equipment and to see where they lose the signal of the GPS. So clearly in France, we are more about 60% of illegal trafficking on the wasties. It was confirmed by our environmental minister very recently. But it is the case in most of Western countries. In our IT equipment, we are consuming a lot of metals. More than half of the Mendeleev table is used. So you have here an illustration coming from the European Union about critical metals and about the effective recycle rates that we can have on the metals that are used for IT. So just to illustrate, if you have your smartphone in your hands, you have about 50 to 60 metals that are used to manufacture it. Of course, they are mixed in a volume that is so low that it's going to be very complicated to recycle your smartphone. Maybe the battery, if it is possible, but you can see there that the lithium that is used in our batteries is still recycled, is not recycled since the rate is 0%. And for critical metals such as gallium or indium, I was talking about, that are used in all optronic applications, so for the fiber by example, but also in LED products, you can see that the recycle is also to 0%. So clearly, there is a high risk of depletion of these resources. And you have below the rare earths with the lanthanide group that is illustrated also. And you can see that there is only one rare earth that is effectively recycled. So this is for the general pictures, and most of the figures were given this morning, so I won't develop no more. How can you contribute as individual? It is the way we are working today in large firms and inside the institute with all our members. First, it is to aware people and final users that they have to request only what they really need to work efficiently. So by example, is it mandatory to have headset with Bluetooth when we are connecting on our computers? Yes, it could be nice to walk in our room while we are speaking, but is it really mandatory? And clearly, we can see in some large companies habits that are very bad, such as changing the headset each time that the air cushions are used, by example. So we can encourage also to use refurbished equipment. Generally, large companies are worried about the end of life of their equipment and try to do that the equipment can be reused. But generally, they don't buy or rent refurbished equipment, while it would be absolutely possible. So we encourage to that. And we encourage also to adopt, bring your own devices. And maybe it can be done in two steps, by example, by buying the equipment that we have used professionally at the end of the contract when it is leased, by example. We have to onboard people to enable and contribute to decommissioning of applications, to remove virtual machines and to unfree spaces on physical machines. So generally, when we have final users, they request very easily their need, but due to the turnover or things like that, sometimes we forget that we have tools that are running on our servers. So we have to work on that, to scan our virtual machines, to map who is using them. And when we see that we don't have any communication for large periods, to ask to our users if we can remove or not. And a clear message is to be life cycle minded. So to act locally, but to think globally, to be aware when we can perform pollution transfer. And I'm going to take a very common example. It is cloud solutions. Today, it is a large tendency to adopt cloud solutions in large companies. clearly, we can close our data centers and say, well, we reduce our electrical consumptions, okay, but we have transferred everything in the GAFAM or elsewhere, somewhere else. So we need to have reporting on what is relative to cloud and the network that is used also with the cloud. And today, it is a kind of black hole to have a quotation of the impacts relative to the cloud and so on. So yes, we are the cloud providers are communicating a lot about renewable energies and so on, but the environmental footprint remains and we have to quantify it. Inside the Institute, we have best practices guides. We have, by example, a guide for sustainable IT purchases that is being updated today, and we want to deploy next year. And a very little action is to remove also IP fixed phones. We have seen that with the lockdown, we are able to use our computers as phones. So we don't need any more IP phones that are consuming every day, 24 hours a day and all the day long. So generally, when we consider the desktop, the fixed phone is the main consumption on our desk. So a little roadmap that is used in my company that I've proposed is to be lifecycle analysis minded, and so to have trainings to increase the competencies on this topic, to eco-design our digital services, so to take into account the environmental footprint. As we are performing secured by design, we would like to be green by design. To work on the eco-labels, it is a very easy way to consider the life cycle assessment without having to compare all the life cycle of our of the equipment that we can buy. So if we define some relevant eco-labels, and it is done inside the Institute, relative to each equipment, we can be very ambitious to say, well, we want, by example, computers that are only TCO certified or EPID certified. But clearly, we encourage to adopt eco-labels that are considering the whole life cycle assessment and not only the energy consumption, such as is what is done by Energy Star, by example. When we are a large company and we have data centers, of course, we have to focus also on data centers, but let's say that it is about 15% of the environmental footprint, so it is not negligible, but it is not the priority either. We are working on the simplification of our architectures, and we have realized a technical complexity index inside our company to map our 6,000 applications and see what is the level of complexity to encourage simplification. And of course, virtualization is key with decommissioning. The Sustainable IT is an initiative that requires the collaboration of all functions of the company, especially procurement, of course, but also facilities management, sustainability, or corporate environmental affairs to address the topics fully. And we are working with our suppliers. So this month, we have launched what we call the request for information to get from our suppliers their maturity on this topic. And so we are evaluating the maturity, and we are going to have exchanges with them to secure their strengths and to encourage to improve their weak points. So I won't develop too much this action plan, but you can see that we are working on competencies. It is key. It is a priority, in my opinion, when we are starting such an initiative. We are working on data centers, on equipment, on communication inside the company, but also outside the company. And this is clearly why I'm there today. We consider also the indirect emissions with the cloud, with the network, and it is a tricky work to do that. And clearly, the regulation is going to pull this reporting, especially in Europe. And the green IT needs to be taken at the governance level for sure to fix priorities and encourage to transition. In the case of Airbus, we are ISO 14001 certified, and clearly this certification is very efficient to adopt a sustainable IT initiative. And of course, we need to work on the digital services itself that is going to require the IT power. I don't forget that we are speaking about sustainable IT and not only green IT. So we need also to work with people, and we are at the convergence of people, planet, profit. So it is key to work also on the acceptability, on the digital inclusions. And I would say that we are all disabled people. So when I had a night that was quite very complicated due to my daughter, by example, I can assure you that I really feel disabled with some IT tools. And we have to fight electronism, what we call electronism also. It means that if there is a digital inclusion, there can be also a digital exclusion. And even when we are graduate in engineering and in IT, we can see that people who are old and don't know the latest technologies feel sometimes very excluded from some positions. And so we want also to consider everybody, even when we have a low background in IT or a high background. So I've tried to respect the time. If you have questions, I'd be more than happy to answer.
Perfect. Thank you, Emmanuel. I suggest that you unshare your screen.
Yeah.
So we can see you.
It is done.
Okay, I see. Okay, perfect. So thank you, Emmanuel, for your presentation. Very interesting. And we had a question on the illegal trafficking. What do you mean by illegal trafficking? The famous 70%, which is huge.
Yes, it's quite easy. Today, the waste of electronic equipment are regulated by Basel Convention. So Basel is a city in Switzerland. This convention was addressing all the hazardous substances. And clearly, e-wastes are part of hazardous substances. This regulation says that when you consume a product in one country, this product has to remain in the country and has to be recycled. And today, the situation is that we see that 70% of this equipment are going out of the countries and finish their life in Ghana, Nigeria, and India mainly. And there is a very good documentary that you can see in English that is Welcome to Sodom. It is available on the net. In French, we have a documentary in 2019 that was called Déchets électroniques, le grand détournement. It was on France 5. It is available also on YouTube. And it, as I told you, it's very easy to verify these figures because you use a GPS tracker in the panels of wastes and you see where it goes. So this illegal trafficking is very profitable. Interpol estimates that it is as profitable as drug markets. And clearly, you can see that the risks are not the same.
Yeah, thank you for the answer. Maybe another answer, you talk about...
Maybe also, it is if you want to find information on that, I encourage you to follow Mike Annan, who is a journalist working in Ghana, who is very involved in this topic. And we are in the period of Christmas. And generally says, well, we know that we are going to receive tons of Wii during this period because we renew our equipment.
Yeah, unfortunately, yes. So you talk about the change management process and the human, let's say, the human well thinking. What do you think is the main obstacle to deploy sustainable IT in large company and why? If we only have one obstacle.
One difficulty could be to quantify the impacts and to quantify the benefits by changing. I'm going to take the example of the energy by example on the data centers. Mm-hmm. If you don't have the meters on your data center and if you don't know what is the consumption of your data centers, it's going to be very complicated to convince the top management that it is profitable to launch actions on that. But I was talking about the ecolabels also. If we want to convince our top management to adopt the ecolabels, we have to find the benefits, not only in euros. It can be in values, and values is not only money, but we have to quantify. And today we are working on that with the Ecolabels also to say, well, it's nice to request to say that it is certified. What is the difference between an equipment that is Ecolabelized and one that is not?
Okay. Thank you for this answer, and it's a perfect transition for my talk just after on the tool and the quantification. So thanks a lot, Emmanuel. Thanks for your time and for your presentation.
You're welcome. And I take the opportunity just to say that inside the Institute, we would like to take an international dimension. So if people know institute, associations, non-governmental organizations that are working on green IT or sustainable IT, really it would be appreciated, especially if they are not French speakers, it would be appreciated that they contact us to federate at least at European level and clearly at world level if we can.
Okay, Emmanuel. And do not hesitate, Emmanuel, to put some links on ENR Institute on the chat.
Yes, so I'm going to do it immediately.
There is a lot of non-French-speaking people, so
yes,
we can help you. Thank you, Emmanuel.
You're welcome. Thank you.